Good morning, Charlie. How's it going today? Good morning. Thank you for being here this morning. You glad to be in the Lord's house today? Amen. Just a reminder, some Sunday unnamed, I'm going to tape some cash underneath the chairs of the front row. But you have to be seated in that chair the whole service if you're going to grab what's underneath the chair. So just so you know, you won't know what Sunday that's going to be, but one of these Sundays, there might be cash underneath the chairs of the front row. I just need to find Joe's wallet first before I do that. Well, it's good to have you. We're glad you're here this morning. If you're with us streaming online, we're glad you're with us that way. As always, please just make sure to interact with each other and comment with one another to try to make that as relational as possible because you're not here in the building. Also, use the share feature to share that with somebody else to invite them to join us even at the moment. Invite them to join us in streaming if you're in the building. And Emilio, would you mind doing a favor? There's a tablet right in front of you in that chair. Can you hit pause for me? It's not my tablet. I'm not watching TV while I'm doing announcements, but thank you. In the back, if you're in the building, in the back there are invitational cards for you to use to invite people to come to church in a general basis, so just make sure to grab those on occasion. Also, you received a flyer for the Easter service next Sunday. Again, that's not your invite. That's for you to give to somebody else. Yes, you are invited. We just kind of expected you'd be coming to church next Sunday, but you know someone who might not be, so use that flyer to hand out to somebody else and invite them to join us. Your friendship and your connection with others is going to be the most effective means of getting people into the body of Christ, so use your friendship to get people to that place. Also, just a reminder of our YouTube channel playlist for teaching stuff. If you're on there, go to the channel and check out the playlist, and there's all kinds of teaching things to apologetics, discipleship, spiritual growth, and those kind of things. So make sure to access that, as well as the Facebook page also. Prayer meeting. Our next prayer meeting is going to be Friday, April the 29th at 1 p.m. in this sanctuary. So if you're willing and available, we meet here to pray for the life of the church and the things that are happening. And I'm believing that God's starting to answer those prayers. So I encourage you, if you can, be here Friday, April the 29th at 1 p.m. Also, today is the last day to sign up and pay for the Easter or for the Seder dinner. So if you would like to be at the Seder dinner, that's this Thursday at 6:30. But the money and sign up is due today. So just make sure to see Bonnie. And if you don't know who Bonnie is, then see all those guys standing in the back there. Those guys will help you find Bonnie if you don't know who Bonnie is, okay? So sign up, turn in your money to Bonnie, and we'll make sure to have a great time this Thursday for the Seder dinner. Also, April 24th at 6:30, so that's a couple weeks from today, is our next worship night. So we're just coming together to worship and seek the Lord. And that's Sunday the 24th at 6:30 p.m. It'll be a great time to just be able to seek Him and worship Him together. So I encourage you to come and be a part of that. All right, if you would stand with me, if you're able, and let's turn our attention to the Lord. Father, thank you so much for the family of God. And we thank you for your provisions and our opportunity to fellowship together and to seek you. And we ask that as we seek your face, that you would demonstrate your love and power towards us, that you would be at work among us, and that you would help, that the song of our heart would be to praise the name of Jesus Christ. May your name be exalted in our midst, in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Let's worship together.
Shown his love, and that a perfect God, an almighty and omnipotent God, would care about you and me. Let's give him praise today. whatever comes, I won't complain. For all my hope, it's in your name, and now your joy awaits my praise. Come on, let's give him praise. I give thanks for all you have done, and I will sing of your mercy and your love. It's my solid rock. Give him praise. Give thanks for all you have done. And I will sing of your mercy and your love. Your love is unfailing. Lord, I am grateful. I give thanks for all you have done. I won't forget. I won't forget all the battles you have won. Your love is unfailing. Lord, I am grateful. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. And as we lift, our hands, the heavens open, heavens open. So let our life declare the love our God has spoken. Give him praise. And as we lift our hands, the heavens open, heavens open. So let our lives declare the love our God has spoken over us. Give him thanks. I give thanks. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I give thanks for all you have done. I won't forget all the battles you have won. Your love is unfailing. Lord, I am grateful. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we give you thanks and we give you praise, Lord, as we recall, Lord, just how worthy, how holy, and how righteous you are, Lord. And Lord, that you would come in your holiness and your righteousness, Lord, in the form of a man, as we're celebrating this time of year, Lord, that you would come and allow yourself, Lord, to be sacrificed in our place. Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, it's in you. Oh, Lord, my God, in you I put my That's why we offer up to him everything.
today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah to your name, Lord. We give you praise. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, I'll sing hallelujah to the Lord. He gave his everything. That's right, give him praise. He gave his all. Thank you, Lord. When you sacrificed your life, Lord, you gave everything that you had. Lord, because that was the price of our salvation, Lord, and you were willing to pay that price. God, we thank you. We give you praise, Lord. Hallelujah.
Praise will rise to Christ our King.
by your Spirit.
By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. Why? 'Cause your resurrected King is resurrecting me. And in your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. And in your name I come alive to declare your victory.
Before you even went to the cross, that you had the power to lay down your life. And God, I'm so thankful that you were willing to lay down your life. But Lord, you also said that you had the power to take it up again. Lord, there were no nails that held you to that cross. It was your love for us, Lord, that took you and held you to that cross, that caused you not to call out to your Father to send angels to rescue you. God, we are forever, forever thankful, Lord. We worship you and praise you. Hallelujah. And Lord, we give you thanks, Lord, for the privilege of coming into your presence and offering up our praise from our lips, Lord, and offering up our prayers. If you have a prayer need, come forward and let us stand with you before God's throne and lift up your needs before him.
Last thing I need is to
was lost. was amazing grace. Oh, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. But now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. It was His grace, it was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears, they were relieved when I realized how precious did that grace appear. The hour I first believed, my chains are gone. Oh, hallelujah! I've been set free. Hallelujah! My God, my Savior has ransomed me. Forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine. Sing, my chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, oh, His grace and His mercy reign. Unending love, amazing.
thank you that when we were in places that we couldn't figure out, we couldn't of our own wisdom and strength find deliverance from, you came in and you set us free. You gave us the ability to overcome. You gave us the ability to move forward. You gave us the wisdom to know how to make sense of life. You gave us the forgiveness, Lord, that though we deserve judgment, condemnation, punishment, we deserve consequence from you. You give us the opposite. You give us life and comfort and joy and peace and provisions, Lord. You give us that. And we ask that you would help us to never, never lose sight of that. That we are undeserving, and yet you are all loving. And we ask, Lord, that as we rest in your presence this morning, as we find comfort in your presence, as we get ready to give, as we get ready to turn to your word, we ask that you would anoint your word, that your hand would be upon me as I speak your word. Because we rely on you, Lord. This, even as the worship team led us, this is not them, though they're willing to serve, they're willing vessels. When I preach, it's not me, though I'm willing to serve and I'm a vessel. We rely on the anointing of the Holy Spirit. In so many things we do, even beyond this service, Lord, each one of us here present today, we depend on the anointing of the Lord to be able to do your work. And so we ask that you would grant us that you would open our eyes to see, and ears to hear what you want to reveal to us today. And we ask that you would set us free from, make us overcomers, over fear and doubt, anxiety, worry and stress. May you set us free this morning so that we can better be able to bring glory to your name. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. God bless you. You could be seated. Amen. And if our ushers would prepare to receive the Lord's tithes and offerings this morning, we thank you so much for your generosity and giving. It's your giving. Though we know all things come from the Lord, it's your willingness to use your finances to give to the, contribute to the work of the kingdom of God. And we know that and we recognize that, so we're thankful for that. And so let's pray for the offering. Lord, we thank you that if we place anything in this offering plate or if we give anything online, it's only because you gave us the ability to have it. And so we are grateful that you've given us all we need for life and godliness. You've given us the needs that we have, you've provided. And we ask that as we give to you, we're trusting that you will continue to do that, that you'll continue to be faithful to each one of us. And we ask also that as we give, that you would use this to build your kingdom. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 If you would, turn with me to Matthew 6. We are on the tail end of Matthew 6. We'll be picking up at verse 25. So we're wrapping up chapter 6. Next Sunday is Easter Sunday, or Resurrection Day, as you know. So we'll be taking a break from the Sermon on the Mount to discuss some things regarding Resurrection Day, but today we're in Matthew 6, verse 25, and you should have a handout, but if you did not receive a handout when you came in, just raise your hand. Okay, so we got a few gentlemen in the back, so someone will come along to get those handouts for you. So there we go, Dwayne's coming, so just keep those hands up. Dwayne is coming with that. Matthew chapter 6. Anybody ever been to the Golden Corral? Okay. Now, some people have love-hate relationships with buffet-style places. Thank you, Caitlin. Some of the love-hate relationship has to do with if you're not there at the right time, the food's all available because it's been sitting there for a while, and you kind of get some lukewarm food. It's not made fresh for you all the time. But there's plenty of it, which is kind of the plus, if you will, but also at the same time, the minus. Anybody ever go to a buffet and you think, why is there so much good food here? Now what am I going to do? And I don't know if you're like me. I have a hard time not making sure I get some of everything that I like. And if the buffet is good enough, well, then you're going to have to go back for a few plates if you're going to do that. Well, I want you to imagine there's two individuals, or there's a group of people at the Golden Corral, and one of the individuals has their back to the buffet line, and they're not looking at the food. And they start saying, you know, I'm just really worried and stressed out because I don't know where I'm going to get food to eat. I'm really concerned about that. I just don't know if I'm going to find enough food. Now, the guy across the table from this gentleman is starting to look at him like, what are you talking about? But the guy just keeps going on, I'm just so worried, I don't know how I'm going to find any food. And the guy says, look behind you, we're at a buffet, you goof. Like, there's food everywhere. So he turns and he looks behind him and he sees that there is plenty of food there. That relieves him for a brief moment before he starts getting stressed again. And the guy's wondering, why is he stressed out? There's plenty of food here to eat. And the guy starts saying, how am I supposed to get the food? It's all the way over there. I don't know how I'm supposed to get the food. There's all kinds of food. I don't know how I'm supposed to get it. And the guy's like, what are you talking about? You just stand up and go over there, grab a plate, and get some food. And he goes, oh, okay. Now, if I was that guy, I'd be confused. Why is this guy so worried when there's plenty of food around and he has the ability to go get it? Did you know that those of us here that find ourselves worried, ever feel worried or anxious or fearful, did you know that most of the time what we're afraid of or anxious about never happens? In fact, most of the time, the things that we're nervous about, stressed about, there's evidence all around us that it will be taken care of. And yet, we many times act like that guy at the buffet who's stressed about food, and yet it's right there for the taking. Now, I don't mean to make light of the things that we have in life to be concerned about, because I know that there are many things in life to be concerned about, aren't there? We, at times, have financial concerns, and we are worried about whether or not we can continue to pay our bills, keep the place that we're living in, keep the car that we have. We're sometimes concerned about our physical condition and our health, and we're in pain and we're hurting, or there's aches and, have you ever wondered, there's aches and pains that I don't know what's causing it, but I'm concerned about that, but I don't want to go to the doctor to find out that it's a bad thing, so I'm just going to pretend like it's not there, okay? But I'm still going to hold that stress inside of me that I'm worried about, that pain that I don't know where it's coming from. Or we have relationship stress and fear and concerns that we have, and we're worried about the state of those relationships. Or we have a house. I have a house that's 118 years old. Okay? It was built in 1904. And it feels like a 1904 house. And there, we've done some things to it, but there's other things that I have concerns about the state of the house. And some of you have houses that you're concerned about the condition of your home. But we sometimes just try to ignore it and pretend like the house isn't going to collapse at some point. Some of you have cars that you're concerned about it. It got you here today, but you're not sure if it's going to get you home today. Hey, or every time you take it for an inspection, your stress level goes sky high because you're worried about when the mechanic calls you and tells you how much the inspection is going to be. Then you factor in the things that are around us, like the gas prices and how inexpensive they are today. You know, if you've ever gone to the pump, it's a very cheap transaction. No, we're moving over four. In fact, I heard some rumors that before this is all over, we might approach $7 a gallon. And that's just one reflection of an economy and inflation that we're sitting in the midst of, just adding to the how can I continue to pay for this stuff. Or we have things like the political climate that we're in, and oh yes, COVID is still kind of in the rearview mirror, but some of the effects of it keep showing up, affecting different things. We also have the political situation with Ukraine and Russia, and what does that mean, and what's going to happen. And we have the spiritual climate in our world today, and where that's headed, and we have all kinds of reasons to be concerned, anxious. Now, I want you to know that some people say, well, I'm not afraid, I'm just anxious. I want you to know that anxiety is just an extension of fear. You're anxious because you're afraid about something. And then some people, once they figure that out, they say, well, I'm not anxious, I'm just stressed. The reason why, and you might not have a phobia that you're hiding in a corner somewhere, but the reason why you're stressed is you're worried, you're fearful that you won't get everything done, you won't get it done correctly, or whatever it is that you're stressed about, you're worried about the outcome, you're fearful about the outcome. And I don't know about you, but I don't really want to be stressed and anxious or fearful. Do you? Any volunteers that you'd like to stay in a state of anxiety in your life? Okay, so then why are we still there? Why do we still feel anxious when we don't want to be in that place? And how do we find a way out of that? Well, Jesus is going to give us some guidance on that. Matthew 6, if you'd look with me. Matthew 6, beginning at verse 25. Jesus says this, again, Matthew 6, verse 25, therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Verse 26, look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. And or are you not of more value than they? Verse 27. And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. Now, a couple of sidebar things before we dive into that. One, notice that he said directly about the birds and then indirectly about the lilies of the field that you are of much more value than they are. Human beings to God are more valuable than plants or animals. Now, I know that some of us might be dog lovers in here, and we might have a hard time imagining that God could love another human being more than my dog. But biblically, that's the reality. And the reason why I point that out is in our modern culture today, it is growing more and more common that people think that it's better for people to die than for the animals to die. It's better for people to die than a forest to be cut down. And that is not a biblical idea. Human beings are more important to God than plants and animals. Does that mean that God wants us to burn down forests and abuse animals? No, it doesn't mean that. But we have to know that if it came down to it, between your life or your dog's life, it's the human life that's more important, okay? So just a sidebar thing there. But we're anxious. Some of us don't want to admit that, but many of us are anxious off and on for different reasons. And what do I do with that? And it may appear when Jesus says, therefore, do not be anxious about your life. It might appear that Jesus is saying to us, just stop it. Just stop being anxious. Have you ever had somebody tell you that before when you were expressing your concerns and your anxiety? And they said, just stop doing that. You think, well, thank you. I'm glad that you gave me that advice. Everything's all better now. It doesn't work like that. And Jesus isn't actually doing that. He's not saying, just stop it. Otherwise, it would just be one verse. Stop it. Okay, but he goes on and on and on a little bit about it with a handful of verses because he had more to say about worry and anxiety. And he's going to show us that we can reduce the stress in our lives by knowing and doing. Well, what is it that I need to know? He first says that life is much more than food and the body is more than clothing. Now, you might get distracted by the word body to think that he's referring to this earthly existence, but I want to remind you, first of all, that when we die, at some point when Jesus returns, we're going to have a resurrected body. So your physical existence does not end when you die, okay? But also, he said therefore to start this out. Have you ever noticed when therefore floats around in the Bible? When therefore is there, you got to know why it's there. And it's a grammatical formula or structure in that whatever I just said, when I say therefore, that means that is the reason why you should do this, or that is going to cause this. And so he says, therefore, do not be anxious. Therefore, what did he just say? Well, if you were here last week, you'll remember that Jesus said to us, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, but treasures in heaven. Which means that what he's talking about right now is being mindful of that what I'm living for are eternal things. Because of that, I should not be anxious. So the first thing you need to know is your existence is bigger than your earthly life. Okay? So when you face death, when death is in front of you, and some of you have come close to it in your life, when death is in front of you, we may initially feel like I have a reason to be anxious and stressed because I could die. But if you know that dying for you, if you're in Christ, is I'm going to relocate, okay? And my relocation is going to involve being in the slums to relocating to the palace, okay? My relocation is going to involve me being in pain and dealing with a lot of headaches and difficulty in life and lacking to relocating to a place where there is no pain and there is pleasure forevermore and there is no lacking, there is constant fulfillment and joy. And so when you realize when I'm facing death that on the other side of that is that stuff, there is a lot less stress that I need to be had knowing that I'm facing death because I know what's happening. Or when you lose a loved one or a loved one is about to die, if they are in Christ, you know that while this might mean that you're moving away for a while and I'm not going to see you for a few years or maybe even a few decades, I know that it's just for a while, and after that time, you and I are going to start hanging out together again. You and I are going to start having conversations again. I'll be able to touch you and see you, and you'll be able to touch and see me. And not only that, but we won't have to be separated ever again. And if you know that that's the reality on the other side, then when your parent, your spouse, maybe even a child is facing death, it's not as stressful because you know, I don't have to worry about this because look what's on the other side. Now you might say, well, what if my loved one isn't following Christ? Well, this is the reason for the storing up for yourselves treasures in heaven. That means you got a lot of praying to do. That means you have a lot of conversations to be had because you know what's at stake and you want to make sure that they're following Christ, not just because you want them to catch religion, not just because you want them to come to church with you, but because you want them to live with you for all eternity, never having to be separated again. And so when you understand that, then you know what matters. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, but treasures in heaven. And so you will pursue that, and once you've done something, and you've prayed, and you've done the things, and the person responds, and they find Christ, then doesn't matter if I die, doesn't matter if they die, because it's just a transition that happens. And if I understand that, when I find myself not able to pay my bills, ever not able to pay your bills or feel like you're not able to pay your bills, when you find yourself in that space, or when your body is hurting, anybody's body ever hurt you before? I'm 43 years old today, and my youngest is, well, this is not my birthday today, sorry, I misled you. I'm 43 years old, and my youngest is 7. And there are times, like yesterday, that all I'm doing is playing with him. And you know what he usually says when he wants to play? I think, let's play a card game. Let's sit down and play a card game or board game. Or I'll play a video game with you. You know what he wants to do? Let's play tag. And he wants to run everywhere. And you would think I'd be faster than a 7-year-old, but I'm not. And I have a 43-year-old body, so if I spend the day playing tag, guess what? My body doesn't feel great today. And some of you have experienced much more pain than what I'm feeling at the moment. And when you find yourself in pain, or not able to pay your bills, or you have conflicts in your relationship, or your house is falling apart, or your car is falling apart, or you lost your job, just remember that this can only last so long. It might last a few years, it might last a few decades, but at some point, this is all going to stop. You see, it's stressful when we think, how am I ever going to get out from under this? But if I know that someday this will all be over, and not only will it be over in the sense it won't be that I'm ceasing to exist, it'll be that it'll all be over, and I'll be in a glorious place, and so I can't pay my bill today? Not worried about it. I'm not stressed because I know at some point, even if I lose this house, at some point I'm going to have a better house than this. I might have to pass through death to get there, but I know it's going to be there. And I know that at some point, though my body's hurting now, it's not going to keep hurting. At some point, it will be over. And if I know that, the stress and the anxiety, those levels begin to drop because I have the right perspective. So I need to know that life is more than this earthly existence. Because that's, when you think about it, when you get stressed, are you stressed about going to heaven? Okay, are you stressed about rewards? And glory and all those things? No, we're stressed about this place. That's the only thing we're stressed about. And so if we have that perspective, those things begin to change. Then I also have to know the reality that if I need it, God will make sure I get it. It might not happen instantaneously, and I know that in our day today, when we're searching something on our phone, and it takes more than 15 seconds for it to pull up, we're losing our minds. If we go through a drive-thru that says fast food, and it takes more than 10 minutes to get your food, we're losing our minds, right? Because we live in the day of instantaneous provisions. 3 minutes, thank you. But God doesn't always work that way. Sometimes he takes his time bringing about the things that we have need of. But understand that if you need it, you will have it. Because he says, the lilies and the birds, if I take care of them, how much more will I take care of you? So if you need it, he will have it. But here's a problem, though. There's three things that we have to uncover here. Here's the problem. The first is we need to understand what a need is and what a want is. Because Jesus didn't say, look at the birds of the air. See those wonderful cars they're driving? Jesus didn't say, look at the lilies of the field. See the amazing shoes that they have and the suits that they're wearing or dresses they're wearing? He didn't say, look at their retirement account. He didn't say that. He didn't say, look, those birds, they are making their mortgage payment. See that? That's great. They have health insurance. They're good. He didn't say that. He said food and drink and clothing. And he specifically says, your father knows what you need, not what you want. Now, will God not give me what I want sometimes? Sure, he'll give you what you want sometimes. But there are many times that he won't give you what you want because he's a good father. I'm not going to let my children stuff themselves with ice cream and cookies all the time, as much as they would love for me to do that for them, because I'm a good father. At least I'd like to pretend like I am. Do you actually need that car you have? Do you actually need the car that you don't have that you really want?
No.
Do you actually need to live in the house you're presently living in?
No.
Do you need to own a house? Thank you for that echo. Do you actually need to own a house and have your deed name on the deed? Do you actually need insurance coverage? Well, I guess today you need insurance coverage or you have to pay some kind of penalty, but which the penalty costs less than the insurance, but never mind that. Do you actually need more than one outfit to wear? No, in fact, when you go back to Jesus' day, they didn't have the amount of clothes that you and I have. Do you actually need to be pain-free in life? Do you actually need to have all your relationships perfectly peaceful? Do you need those things?
No.
We want them. It would be wonderful to have those things, but do I need them? No. You know what I need? Food and water and Jesus, thank you, and Jesus and clothing. I'd prefer you to wear clothing, so we need clothing. And if I realize that, because I bet you that most of the things you're stressed about aren't the things you absolutely have to have. They're the things that you would prefer to have. Maybe you've had for years and years and years, but you don't actually have to have those things. And if I realize that I don't actually have to have it, then guess what? When it goes, it's all right. I didn't have to have it. Okay? You're making yourself stressed because you're determined to have things that you don't need to have. And so I first need to recognize, do I actually need it? What is the difference between a need and a want? Then I also have to acknowledge the evidence for survival all around me. Jesus calls our attention to it. He says, look out there. Look at the birds. Look at the lilies, the flowers out there. Look at them. Do you see them scurrying around, stressed out that they're not going to find anything? They're fine. Look at that. In fact, he can call attention to ourselves as well. So I want you to think about something. Is it possible for an animal to starve to death? Absolutely. But how many squirrels have you found lying around on the ground dead from starvation?
Absolutely zero.
Thank you. How many robins have you found lying around on the ground dead from starvation? How many human beings have you found lying around dead from starvation? Again, are there people who do face those things in the world? Absolutely. But how often is that actually happening? Is it likely that you're going to starve to death? And all around you, it's like you're sitting in the buffet. All around you is evidence that you will have what you need, and you're stressed out about not having what you will need. If you're here right now alive, you know what that means? That means you've always had enough food to stay alive. You wouldn't be here if that was the case. So look around you. Look at all the people around you. All the people around you, they're evidence that God gives us what we need to survive. So if I know that, why am I so stressed out? Because I am worried about the hypothetical. Have you ever heard those people say, well, I don't know why you're stressed out because that's not actually happening to you. Well, what if it did happen to me? You know, like I don't like driving over bridges. Anybody like me? I don't like driving over bridges. Okay? Okay. I don't like driving over bridges. And the reason is because I don't like heights. And I want you to think about, you're driving over a bridge with a friend, and they say, well, I don't know if I want to go over the bridge because it might fall. They said, well, have you seen a bridge collapse yet? Well, there was that bridge on the news a few months ago that collapsed. Well, but how many times have you driven over a bridge and it collapsed? Never. But what if it does? Because that's really what we're stressed about, aren't we? What if that happens? And again, I ask you, how many things have you been worried and stressed about that never actually happened? Thank you, Melissa, for that. Amen. If we are honest with ourselves that I don't need that thing I'm worried about, even if it's a relationship or aches and pains, I don't need that thing. If you realize that everywhere around me, even my own life, is evidence that God will take care of my survival, what are you so stressed out about? Or maybe the other thing we need to understand is, he says, how much more will your heavenly Father feed you? Do you really believe that God is your loving Father? Because if you believe that, you wouldn't be thinking, well, I don't know if he's going to take care of me. Because you, whether it's your own guilt over your own sin or something, or whether it's your insecurities or whatever it is, but remember that you think that you're degrading yourself when really you're degrading God, because you're saying God isn't a loving enough Father to take care of me. And I want you to know that that is not true. You might be a sinner. You might have made mistakes. You might have done horrible things in your life. You might have offered nothing in life, but I want you to understand something. Jesus, your Heavenly Father, God, loves you, and He will take care of you. And if you know that, don't you want the stress level to go down? I think some of us want to hold on to it. I think we like it too much. We like to have a reason. Have you ever seen those commercials for, what is it, BJ's Wholesale Club, where I don't know if I want the gas prices to go down because then I won't be able to complain about them. The other thing is, Jesus said, who of you can add 1 hour to your life by worrying? Fear and stress and anxiety doesn't actually accomplish anything. Unless, because it is okay that we get concerned and that motivates us to do something about it. Okay, so I think that's why initially that comes, is I'm concerned, so I do something about it. Maybe sometimes the doing something about it is just praying, whatever, but I do something about it. Because Paul says in Philippians, be anxious for nothing but in everything by prayer. However, other than doing something, when have you ever stressed yourself out and found out that your bills got paid because of it? Just sitting around on my couch worrying and to death, and all of a sudden I found out my rent payment got paid because I was sitting here stressing. Which one of you guys have ever found yourself getting physically healed because you sat on your couch stressed out and worried? Which of you have ever found your relationship conflicts resolved because you found yourself stressing? Which ones of you have ever found yourself getting your house fixed up because you were stressed and worried? I mean, I would love it if I could sit in my basement and get stressed about the foundation of my house and all of a sudden it just fixed itself because I stressed it into existence. You don't stress anything into existence. Did you know that? Your stress and your worry and your anxiety is doing nothing for you. So why are you holding on to it? Jesus says, do not be anxious for your life, because we have all kinds of reasons not to. And if we know that, then we will find our stress levels beginning to drop. But we can't just know things. We also have to do certain things. And the things that we need to do is seek first His kingdom and His righteousness. I am venturing to guess here, but if you are a typically stressed person, anxious person, I would guess that there's something wrong in the kingdom of God spot for you. I want you to think about what your prayer life looks like right now. I want you to think about the way you're spending time in God's Word. I want you to think about your involvement in Christian fellowship. I want you to think about whether or not you're living righteous for the Lord or living in sin. I want you to think about if you're participating in ministry, if you're being in the house of God. I want you to think about those things, if you're sharing your faith with others. I want you to think about those things. And I bet that if you're stressed or worried, something in that circle is off. Because Jesus didn't say, work your job and seek to pay your bills and seek to take care of things and seek the doctor out to get things taken care of, and all these things will be added to you. He didn't say that. He said, seek first the kingdom, then all these things will be added to you. So if you are stressed and worried and anxious, I bet that there's a shift that needs to happen in where you're spending your time. Now, does that mean that I can't take care of other things? No, it doesn't mean that. But that means that if I need to change something so that I'm seeking God's things, don't you want to be rid of the stress? Yes, but you don't understand. I got all this stuff to take care of. You don't want to be free from stress, but you don't understand what I have to deal with in my life, right? But do you want to be free of stress? Because who's choosing not to seek the kingdom of God? And if we want to be free from stress, we can't just know certain things. We also have to start seeking the kingdom of God. But notice he says, seek first. He doesn't say, seek only the kingdom of God. He says, seek first. Now, he might give you the impression, because he says, then all these things will be added to you, that that means that if we just do all of God's work, then all the bills, the payments will just drop out of the sky. I mean, that's usually what happens to me when I leave church. I drive home, and when I get home, a briefcase of cash falls down and lands on the hood of my car. That's how I live. Okay? No, that doesn't happen to you? That's weird. Do you? Okay, so you need to visit Molly. She has a money tree in her backyard. Now, understand that sometimes that does happen. And if you ever want to talk to Joyce, she has some stories about that happening. I'm sure there's other people that have stories about that happening. Because that does take place at times. You're doing God's work, and then you look back at your earthly stuff you need to be responsible for, and you're like, it's all covered. All right, I'm going back to this. And that happens in life. That's wonderful when God does that. But sometimes, because Paul says in Thessalonians, if they will not work, neither let them eat. We also have all kinds of instructions in Scripture about how we need to be wise with our resources and money, and we need to take care of certain things. And so sometimes what's happening is that crazy guy at the Golden Corral, anybody hungry for Golden Corral about now? Yes. That crazy guy at the Golden Corral, who knew there was food back there behind him, was stressed and asked, how am I supposed to get the food? God gave you a body and a mind that you're capable to do things with. And so if you find yourself stressed that you can't pay your bills, go out and look for a job. Well, but you don't understand. I can't find a job. Because I've had some people find jobs offered to them when they're struggling financially, and they said, well, but that job is beneath me. I don't want that kind of job. And I'm thinking, you're stressed out because you can't pay the bills, and here's a person saying, I will hand you a paycheck if, and you're telling me you won't take the paycheck because it's beneath you to work somewhere? Or, but I don't want to work a second job, right? I just want to be able to work my 9-to-5 job Monday through Friday, and that's it. That's all I want to do. If God gave you the ability to get the income to get that second job, then you need to do something. Because I think sometimes, again, we actually think, if I sit here on my hands and just get stressed out about my bills and all my stuff, then it'll just all get taken care of. And God is saying, do something. Get up and seek the kingdom of God first, but don't seek it only. You do something about your situation because God has given you something to do about it. So if you're complaining about your health, but you're not exercising, not eating right, and you're saying, God, I can't believe all I eat is ice cream and cookies, and I feel miserable, and you're not changing my health situation. God, every time I step on the scale, I seem to be gaining weight, and you should make me thin out, Lord. I should be able to eat all ice cream I want and be thin and look good. It doesn't work that way. The relationships that you find in conflict and you're stressed about it, but you're not talking to them. You're not going to them and owning up for the things that you did wrong and apologizing. You're not taking the time to make that stressful phone call to talk, because when we're upset with someone, do we really want to talk to them? No. But if you want the relationship to be healed, guess what? Don't just wait for them to call you. You be the one to start to do something about it. And if we learn to be seekers first of the kingdom, then to be responsible for the other things, then we're going to find ourselves less stressed. And this is the way it should work. Kingdom first, these things second. But don't get lost back over here, because sometimes you start to see that, look, I can make some good things happen and make some things better. And you know what you start doing all your time? Doing this stuff. You need to watch that. You need to say, all right, is that good? It's good. Back to this. Let me check back. Okay, some things aren't good. Let me tend to that. Is it okay? Back to this. This needs to be the first priority. And if I'm learning to keep that first, and stepping up and doing something instead of being the guy at the Golden Corral that's stressed about food because I won't walk over there and grab a plate. Do you want to keep staying stressed, anxious? Do you, or would you like to be delivered? Jesus is showing us the freedom from anxiety is right there for the taking if we would just take it. The last thing, though, he says, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will have enough to worry about on its own. And what he's saying to us is, if you can't do anything about it right now, then don't worry about it. And you might say, well, that's easier said than done. And you might say, well, does Jesus not want me to plan? No, he's not saying that you can't plan, because there's plenty of comments in Scripture that refer to the idea of planning. God has plans. Did you know that? So there's nothing wrong with plans and getting things situated. So like if you're worried about retirement now and you can save some now, then start saving today, right? But that's because I can do something. If you're worried about your house now, start doing certain things to get it situated today if you can. But if you can't do anything, if that person's not talking to you or that person is not near you enough that you can have a conversation with them, if you can't do anything about it, then stop worrying about it. Well, I have to worry about it because worry makes things better. Does it? Okay. If you're worried about your bill that's due in 3 weeks from now, and as long as you're managing your money and you're going out there and trying to get work or whatever to get help or you're seeking assistance, I can't tell you how many times I get people asking me for the church to give them money, and I say, well, hold on, here's a list of places that takes care of that very thing. Will you contact them? And you know what they do? Well, I didn't know if I wanted to. I don't know. Have you ever had people say something like that and it sounds so clear? Well, I don't know. And I'm thinking, wait a minute. You're stressed about your rent payment, and these people will help you, and you can't just make a phone call? Well, but what if the first group says no? I don't care if the first 8 groups says no. If you're worried about your financial situation, you work to make sure that something happens. Does that mean we don't ever end up in a bind? Does not mean we don't end up in bad places? No. But if you can do something about it, do something about it. If you can't, why are you stressing out? Because that doesn't make anything change. You find yourself stressed, anxious, worried, fearful about one or many things. Do you want to stay in that place? Or would you like to be delivered? Will you stand with me? Worship team, will you come and prepare to lead us? Some of you are stressed and anxious, and I would love to say that I myself am totally free from that. But I would think that any one of us would be lying if we were to say that we never experience stress or worry or anxiety. But some of us have it worse than others. Some of it we just have a little bit of it, but wouldn't you like to be afraid of, or delivered of the little bit of it, okay? And so what I'm going to do as the worship team leads us, you have an opportunity to come down to these altars and deal with the anxiety that you're carrying on your shoulders. And you also have the opportunity to leave it there. Wouldn't you rather leave it there and walk away from it than to keep retaining it? But there's two things that we need to keep in mind when we come to Jesus this morning. Is one is that he has comfort for us. The other is that he has a correction for us. The comfort he has for us is you are more valuable than the birds and the lilies. Jesus values you. I want you to think about that for a moment. You, the person who has nothing to offer. You, the person who doesn't have everybody looking at you because of how good you look or how smart you sound. You, the person who has messed up so many things time and time again. And I want you to know that I'm talking about me also. You, who's just the tiny speck on the timeline of human history. You, who have so often said, I can't do anything about this because I don't have the power to do it. You are the person that the God, the infinite creator of the universe, says, I value you. So you, who's stressed out and worried and shouldn't be that way, you, he says, I value you. So when you come to these altars, you're going to seek the God who wants you. But he also has a correction. He says, which one of you can add an hour to your life, O you of little faith? If you have any stress, worry, fear, anxiety in your life, it's a lack of faith. I'm not saying you don't believe in Jesus. I'm not saying you don't believe that Jesus rose from the dead. I'm not saying you don't believe in heaven. But some part of you doesn't have faith. And you know what faith is? Faith is trusting. And some part of you do not trust that God cares enough about you that he's going to take care of that. It might be a small thing. I don't know. But some, and I'm not telling you my opinion. I'm telling you it's right there in the passage we read. If we are struggling with this, it's because there's something lacking in our faith. And I don't know about you, but I'd like that to be restored. Wouldn't you? So we have an opportunity to seek the Lord here this morning and have that changed, to do something about it. Come on, start to seek Him if that's you. Do something about it. Don't just stay in your pew or your chair, and wait for God to take care of something. Step out from the chair, come down these aisles, and kneel at this altar. And it's okay if you're in front of other people and they see you doing that. It's okay to admit that you're stressed, because guess what? When I'm done talking to you, I'm going to go right over there and do the same thing. But you have to do something about it. He's here, and He wants, don't you want to be free from it? Let's be free from it today. Let's seek Him.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know you're in this place. Please let me stay.
Love is that. It's the love that the Lord has for us that is perfect. Perfect love casts out all fear. And though the words of these songs don't exactly have everything to do with what the Lord talked about in this passage, I think it's reflective in some way of it. Because if we let the Lord come in and wash our eyes to see around us His faithfulness, if we seek a revelation from God to know that He's with us, perfect love casts out all fear. So what we need more in our life is not more money, though that would be great, not less pain. We need more of the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. So as they sing this through once more, verse and chorus, let's keep that in mind of what we're asking for. Lord, reveal yourself to me, and then I'm going to rest in absolute peace with no anxiety, no worry. It's okay, the child's good. And let's sing that. Sing this hymn. Yes, Lord. Seek this.
I'm finding myself in the midst.
rest of you beyond, beyond the music, beyond the noise. And all that I need, Lord, is to be with you, and in the quiet to hear your voice. Oh, word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know you're in this place.
Nothing magical about closing your eyes, but sometimes it helps us to not be distracted by what's around us. And I want you to, as we just sang, being in the quiet place and having peace in that spot, eyes closed for just a moment, I want you right now to just begin to think of all the ways that God has been and is being faithful to you at this moment. We sing a song, count your blessings, name them one by one. I want you to think about all the ways that God has been faithful to you and see if a peace begins to surface just for a moment. If we would, instruments silence for a moment. Let's just get in perfect silence and rest in His peace just for a moment. Dwell on. Now, if you would, just begin to express your gratitude to the peace He's giving you, the provisions He's given you. Lord, thank you so much. Thank you for everything you've given me. Thank you, Lord, I have clothes on my body, Lord. Thank you, Lord, I can walk around. I have breath in my lungs. Thank you, Lord, I have a family. Thank you, Lord, that you provide for me. Thank you, Lord, that I know you. Thank you that I have an eternal future ahead of me. Thank you, Lord, that I have a joy in my heart. Thank you that I have peace in my spirit. Thank you that I have a wonderful church family that surrounds me. Thank you for that. Thank you that I live in a city that gives me certain freedoms, Lord. Thank you for that. Thank you for the wisdom you've given me. Thank you for the word that you've given me from the Bible, Lord. Thank you for writing that for us. Thank you. Thank you for your love and your goodness to us. And Lord, we ask that as we get ready to move on, we ask that you would continue to help us to walk fearlessly. That even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil. Help me. Help all of us to be that. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. He is faithful. He is faithful. He's got your back. He will get you. Amen. And you know that. You know that more than some of the people in your life. And so why not invite them to be a part of what God's doing here so that they can see what God's doing here, and there's a reason they should be here. So use that invite, and next week we're going to talk about joining the group that benefits you, finding purpose, finding support, finding His presence. What does that have to do with Easter? Well, when Jesus died and rose from the dead, He made a declaration to us, and we call it the Great Commission. And we're going to look at that next week and what all that means for us. So would you invite someone? Will you stand with me? Would you invite someone to be a part of that? And I believe God has great things in store for us, for you, and for me. It might not be all our wants. It certainly is all our needs. Amen? Amen. Thank you for being here. I love you. God bless you. See you next Sunday.